Para el agua. ¿Vos te querés parar para?
Ya hay conectado, ya hay conectado 1800.
Buenísimo.
Parece en sachet de leche, pero es agua.
Sí, hay. No sé cuánto.
Bueno, cuando ustedes me dicen. Okay, we good to start? Okay, so we'll start. Thank you for being here and welcome to this panel, which is on opportunities and challenges in the design of climate smart production systems. We have very good speakers today to tell us from their own perspective, to show their perspectives on this topic. First, we'll have, just to let you know a little bit about the dynamic of the panel, we'll have presentations by each of the speakers and then a short Q&A or exchange between speakers and questions from the audience. So let's get started. First, I will introduce Martin Fraillo. Martin is a bioenergy consultant and agricultural producer. He is the founding member of GPS Argentina. GPS is a group of southern countries, producers, southern countries. He's the founder and then the director of Carbon Group as well. He's a consultant member of CARI, which is the Argentine Council for International Relations, and former director of MAISAR and MAISOL. MAISOL is correct, yes. He's also a professor of agribusiness and bioenergy and at the University of San Andres, ITBA, and the National Technical University. So without further ado, please go ahead.
So I will start. Thank you very much, Cecilia. It's always a pleasure to be part of these activities that IICA is organizing at this COP. And we think it's a very interesting COP. And I would like to discuss tonight in this meeting that we have quite late here in Sharm el-Sheikh, a couple of ideas that we're seeing from GPS. First, present. Next, please. So the title that I put is quite complex, but it's Natural Climate Solutions, Financial Instruments, Carbon Markets for Net Zero for a Region. So what does that mean? How do we get there? How can we transform the way in which we manage our ecosystems or our productive natural ecosystems to achieve net zero? Let's go. Next, please. Okay, so what this organization that's called GPS is a network that was founded in 2012, almost 10 years now, of private sector entities from Uruguay, Paraguay, Brazil, and Argentina. And we act mainly and initially, and it was created to discuss food security from our region, because as you know, the region, our four countries are key, are the main net exporters in the world. So our participation in global commodities market is absolutely vital. So, and the idea is to contribute to the integration of our four countries, and it's created by different institutions, experts, and entrepreneurs from the from these countries. From that initial vision of food security, we moved into sustainability and into interlinking, you know, our different institutions. Next, please. So today we're working in geopolitics of food, the regional integration of our countries and our value chains, and the international development of trade, finance, and investment along the agribusiness value chains. And of course, it's very important for us to debate along climate change and sustainability. Next, please. Okay, so I think in order for these minutes that we have to discuss what it is, climate change, I think it's represented on this slope. We might think that this slope was designed or drawn by Greenpeace or some other NGO, but no, this is the work of ICC and what's called the exponential roadmap. What this shows is what humans, we must achieve related to greenhouse gas emissions. As you can see here, now we have all these emissions and sectors like energy, industry, buildings, and transport must go to zero emissions by 2050 and more or less decrease by half by 2030. So this is not very simple. And if we think individually, we must do this with our cars, our electricity, our microwave ovens, et cetera. We must go to zero. We have no alternative. And this is what the private sector is saying. ICC has 45 million member companies in 140 countries. And there's consensus on this. But if you look at the bottom, you find food. We must continue producing food for an extra 2 billion people, probably, or at least 1 billion by 2050. But at the same time, related to food, there is a large part of the global population that should be included in the middle class, and their consumption will also increase, especially in higher emitting types of foods, right? But if you look at the bottom, the green part here says nature-based sources. And this is what we're doing with ecosystems now. Ecosystems today, as we're managing them, they are emitting greenhouse gases. And when you look at what is it that we must do, we not only go to zero, but we are supposed to store in a long-term sink an enormous amount of CO2 that is today floating in the atmosphere or that will be emitted during this process. And this is the only way that we will be able to keep our climate within the 1.5 target that the Paris Accord is all about. So in order to, next please. So in order to do this, right, we understand that massive, enormous investments must be done globally, right? And so what are investments related to climate change? Last year at COP26 in Glasgow was presented this, which continued to grow during this year, during 2022, was presented by the Glasgow Financial Alliance for Net Zero. What they studied is, okay, what are these investments? What is it that the world has to do in money terms in those things that must go to zero? And when we see this, the numbers are quite relevant. We're today investing $0.9 trillion annually in climate change related things, right? This is the historic investment, but it must go until 2025. It must almost triple, then multiply by four by 2030 and go reach around $5 trillion per year in investment. One thing that I wanted to leave tonight as a question for us or related to climate, to natural climate solutions or nature-based solutions is why is it that in the vision of these experts that include most of the global banks and investment funds, why is it that they see that for AFOLU, which is agriculture, forestry, and land use, there's only such a small fraction of these huge investments in climate change? If we go back to the slide I just showed, it was clear that not only agriculture has to go to zero, but also has to transform itself into an enormous sink. So I think, and one of the ideas that I wanted to leave tonight is we need to work with these people to have them understand that the investments in agriculture and in natural ecosystems and productive ecosystems should increase, not only because there is a lot of demand on capital for these improvements, but also because the opportunity to create more value, to create products, to develop technologies will be in most cases as profitable or even more profitable than in the other sectors. Next, please. So one other idea that I wanted to leave tonight, and we have just very few minutes, is the link between investments, between the goals that we just showed and the carbon markets. Because one very important thing that happened since 2015 is the approval of the Paris Accord as it is now, including Article 6. And the importance of Glasgow was not only, it's from my point of view, the first financial COP, but also the COP at which Article 6 was approved And the rule book was finally designed. So we're working from ICC again, and I'm part of the ICC, ICC Argentina Climate and Energy Commission, and also of the Global Working Group on Carbon Pricing. And so from this commission and this work, right, we understand that carbon pricing and emissions trading are the most economically effective way of reducing emissions. We cannot invest in solutions that are too expensive or that are fancy or that will create stranded assets. We cannot put the funds, right, that humanity needs to focus on creating the most effective solution. We cannot do that. And we understand today, and there is plenty of academic information on how emissions trading and putting a price on carbon is so critical to align and to give north to these investments. So what are some ideas of these 10 principles on which we're working at ICC? First, we need to tackle climate change at a quantitative and time scale that is really unprecedented, right? And we need to do it at the lowest cost consumers and society can afford. We must transform all that transformation into something that creates more value and more economic activity. We understand, and there was extensive debate last night in this same EECA room about competitive distortions, about destroying the capacity of markets, especially in agriculture. Agricultural negotiations have been very difficult since the creation of the GATT, of the GATT. And we understand that climate change cannot be another way of distorting our markets. We need climate change to improve our markets, to make market access better, and to eliminate subsidies. And also, we think that policymakers need to give companies, need the private sector, needs our governments to support, right, to give immediate, medium and long-term frameworks and policy clarity to support their investment decisions. I was this morning at the bingo briefing, and there was a person giving ideas on how the Article 6 negotiations were doing. And they unfortunately were not very optimistic, because again, instead of focusing on how it will be implemented so that for those countries that can provide carbon credits and the countries that will need them to buy and compensate their emissions, there is a debate that is not pulling us forward. Let's hope that this year at COP that is solved. Next, please. Okay. Thank you. So from this work, we are working on this first stage from ICC on 10 principles that are quite simple, but we think these principles are basic for our countries to develop our presence in the global carbon markets, both the voluntary and what might turn out of the three possibilities, or at least the two possibilities of Article 6 that are Article 6.2 and 6.4. So first is to focus on greenhouse gas emission, right? We need to work on this. Second is we need to create a reliable, predictable, and overall framework. We know that the voluntary carbon markets and institutions like Vera have worked very hard and kept a record on doing this workable and reliable. Now we need to apply it to Article 6. Third, we need to promote consistency between what? Climate, energy, trade, and taxation. All of this needs to promote activity at the same time it promotes decrease in emissions. A robust transparency framework, accessibility and affordability of the low carbon energy sources, international linking of carbon pricing. This is critical for Article 6. And well, in important other aspects that we don't have much time today to discuss. But the basic part of this work at ICC is first to set the principles, try to support governments, try to support private sector in different countries. And the second stage is to move on into helping capacity buildings so that our farmers and industries can reach carbon markets to increase or to create the highest value possible. Next, please. So when we think about carbon markets, also the question is, okay, how big will they be? How relevant are they going to be? And we understand now from different studies, and this one is very interesting, done by AIDA, that's just around the corner, is the International Emissions Trading Association and the University of Maryland. This was published last year. And they estimate that carbon markets will reach $1 trillion by 2100, and around 300 to 400 billion by 2050. What does this mean? What this means is, from the total investments humanity needs to do, carbon markets will trade between 5% and 10% of those investments. Why is that important? Because trading that volume will assure that we have a reasonably acceptable price for carbon. We cannot accept what we have today. It's $1 per ton price in some countries and 80 in the EU or some other place. That's not acceptable. We need something that actually operates globally. And that's why it needs to be a big market, and it needs to have access to all countries. And that's one of the things that we need to support our governments in developing countries, my side. And well, some of us here, we think Argentina and the Argentine government need support, but many other countries as well today are not quite understanding well what this means and how relevant it is. We know from agriculture that markets that don't trade 100% of a product can still be relevant when setting a price. Like in Argentina, we have what was called the Mercado de Líneas, right? And we know that 5-10% of the steers that were sold there were enough to set a transparent price for the whole economy. Next, please. And one of the works that we did in Argentina, this is a work that we presented lately and will be published as a book in a couple of months, is to understand the potential of nature-based solutions from a voluntary carbon market perspective. So these six sectors that we chose respect fully the norms that are applicable today from the voluntary carbon market. The idea behind this work that is done by the National Academy of Engineering and the Argentine Center of Engineers, so it's not an agricultural-led activity. The idea behind this is to understand, okay, what is the potential of our sectors? If the investments are there, what is the potential to create mitigated emissions or carbon sequestration? Why? Because we have another resource that in Argentina is called Vaca Muerta, that what if we could develop, if we could have the capital to export natural gas whose emissions, whose greenhouse gas emissions are being compensated by the investments and by the carbon capture and mitigated emissions in agriculture. So what are these six sectors that we chose? The first is to stop deforestation in Argentina, go to not zero, but decrease it by 80%, okay? And that would create 37 million tons of CO2 per year. Second, avoided degradation. That's the technical term in the carbon market, but that means that all ecosystems that today are being degraded will stop in 80%, not 100%. Third is the potential of carbon, of soil, of SOC, of soil organic carbon, to stop where there are emissions and to start sequestering to the potential that was published a couple of months ago in a work between the FAO and the ministry that we had the chance of participating in. One of the members of Carbon Group, Guillermo Peralta, is the lead author of this work. Fourth is decrease enteric emissions from cattle, including in this case, the use of nutritional additives, but mainly done through improved grazing, improved herd management, increase in the KPIs that we all know about in the reproductive and productive activities. Afforestation, to increase forestry. The old forestry plants in Argentina have failed. This is only 1 million hectares of forest. I'm done. Last, avoided emissions from organic urban solid waste and wastewater sectors. We have a huge problem in Argentina in our dumps. The Buenos Aires dump from a satellite a couple of weeks ago, ranked first globally, the worst methane emissions from a dump in the world in winter in Buenos Aires. And all of this would create 131 million tons of CO2 that would be enough to cover the emissions of all of around $40 billion per year of exports of methane. These are huge investments. This one alone is enormous, but this can change the way of life of millions of people in our country. Maybe half the population can improve their quality of their water. Okay, last. Next, please. Okay, so just a few ideas, right? We understand that all sectors of the economy globally in our countries must reconfigure their activities. And this will take from $130 to $250 trillion per year, which is unprecedented in human history. Our countries, Argentina, Brazil, Paraguay, and Uruguay, and the rest of Latin America need to make massive investments. Why? Because we want to remain within that slope that I chose. And we also need to maintain our role as global net food exporters. Farmers and their value chains have one of the greatest responsibilities. We saw that it's not just going to zero. We must also sequester carbon in our soils. And that's called natural climate solutions. Our ecosystems can mitigate enormous amounts of emissions and sequester soil like no other region. That is very important for us. Carbon markets are key. For what? For pricing CO2 and guiding the lowest cost pathway. We must do it efficiently at the lowest cost. We cannot throw away money. This is not helicopter money. This is money that we need to take very good care of. And one of the things is that we're seeing an action and misunderstanding of some governments. And we think that the leadership of the private sector of our institutions, I think ICC in that sense is doing a great job. This working group on carbon markets is the leaders are here. I think we really need to support our governments from these international organizations like IECA in many aspects, from the minimal tiny details of the norms or the protocols to the greatest, transparency and other things that are critical for carbon markets. I think we're okay. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. And thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin, so much for your presentation. Very complete and going over both opportunities and challenges of the agriculture sector in climate change. Now we are going to go to our next speaker, Christian Felkamp. Christian is an agricultural engineer, and he also holds a PhD from Humboldt University in Berlin. He was a lecturer and keynote speaker in several conferences, both in Argentina and abroad. He was a consultant both for the private and public sectors, and currently he is the executive director of CREA. CREA is a highly recognized organization of farmers in Argentina. So I'll give the floor to you, Christian. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Cecilia. Thank you, Ica, again for receiving us and trying to give our view about the opportunities and challenges. Who we are, CREA is a farmer organizations. We are more than 2,000 farmers in Argentina that we gather since 60 years. To exchange knowledge, to exchange ideas, to empower ideas, and to generate new knowledge and to improve. Our idea basically is to share knowledge, information between us, and that's the way that we have to learn and to improve our systems, and it's working. And now it's representing about between the 5 and 30% of the agricultural production in Argentina, and we are covering the whole country. So we cover completely different production systems. And since the very beginning in CREA, the driving force was sustainability. At the very beginning, 60 years ago, was wind erosion of the soils. But with the time, these kind of problems were quite solved. And we realized that the sustainability issues were escalating, and they are now outside our farm gates. Now they are global issues. So we are involved very much in these global issues since 20 years ago, specifically with climate change. And regarding this, and I think it's very important to share with you from where I'm talking about, from where Crea is talking about, to share what do we believe regarding climate change. Because sometimes I have the feeling that there are kind of three kind of actors in the world. We believe that our ship is sinking. There is a hole in the ship below the line of the water and it's sinking. And there are a lot of people trying to solve this hole. But at the same time, in the same ship, we have people selecting a better menu in the restaurant. And there are some people trying to get the rooms of those who are trying to solve the problem with the hole in, under the water. So in Korea, we believe in climate change. And we believe it because there are signs behind that. And I think it's very important to say that because we are convinced that we are in a crisis. So if there is a crisis, of course, you have to prioritize these issues. And that's the reason that we are also supporting ICA and in this, we think, extremely good idea. We believe that climate change is the main challenge that we have as humankind. It's the main challenge because of the complexity and because of the impact. And we share this vision with ICC and hundreds and thousands of other organizations and people, experts, and companies all around the world. But I think it's very important to say that because, of course, nobody in the COP will come here and say, we don't believe in climate change. But we are completely committed to be part of the solution because we also believe, and we have data to show that the agricultural sector is now responsible in Argentina for about 39% of the emissions, of the balance emissions, and less the minus the sequestration, but we don't have data of sequestration. So far we have only the data of emissions, 39%, but we also believe that we are part of the solution. And we believe that because we have data also showing that we have the chance to reduce not only to reduce the emissions, but also to increase the sequestration that is so much needed, as you mentioned beforehand, Martin. I would love to be part of this huge dark green area. Yeah, that's it. So far it's no chance, but we have to build it. Yeah. We have to do it. So Crea is we acknowledge this to be part of the problem, and I think we are convinced that to acknowledge that is the first step to try to solve, and we work, as I mentioned, to be part of the solution. Also, we are convinced that this solution should be with the people, with the producers, with the environment. Climate change is the overriding effect that impacts all around. But we have other indicators, other attributes of the environment that we also think that we have to protect. Biodiversity is one of them. Of course, there is a huge interaction between both, but there is no simple solutions. We have to consider the environment as a whole, because otherwise we are going to have problems in the midterm. There is no solution. We don't believe in solutions, quick solution, quick fixes without the people. And I say this in a country that we have 35% of the people below the poverty line. So we acknowledge the necessity to develop the country as well. And we share these issues, not exactly the same figure, but the same challenge with most of the Americans. We know that for at least for the NDCs of Argentina for 2030, that it is pretty achievable to reduce the emissions in regards to our goals, our NDCs. And a couple of examples on that that could be a factor of way to reduce that is, on the one hand, on livestock sector, in the beef sector, which is about 20% of the emissions of Argentina, we have the chance with few improvements in efficiency to increase the efficiency and to reduce the intensity of the emissions. How many kgs of CO2 equivalent per kg of carcass weight? We can reduce it at least 15%. With known, well-known techniques, well-known technologies, well-known management husbandry practices, we can achieve that. We also, because we have a work paper published together with WWF from Argentina, Fundación Vida Silvestre, we work with them and we found these numbers. Also in the crop sector, we know that with few practices, we can reduce between 15 and 25% of the emissions. Well-known practices, the sequence of crops to increase the share of cereals, maize, wheat, in our sequence of crops. It is possible to, and we have the models, the numbers to show that. It is published. So it is quite interesting to see that with the NDCs that Argentina has, it is possible to reduce between 15 and 25% of the emissions. And of course, land use should or must reduce because of the prohibition of the deforestation. So it is possible to reduce for 2030 a lot our emissions with well-known technologies. Maybe one of you can raise a hand and say, why don't you do it? And I think we need an alignment between the long terms and the short term. An alignment of the framework, of the environment where all the producers are taking, we are taking decisions. And you mentioned the framework that we need for carbon pricing, but I would say the framework of the policies that we need to have foreseeable horizons, to have policies that also promote these long-term views. We are aware that the governments need money and the taxation is a way to get this money, but sometimes these taxation systems emphasize the short term and promote short term decisions. So if you promote short term decisions in the farmers, you are going to have less practices that are aligned with reducing the emissions. So I think for the farmer, not only I think, it's we know that for the farmers, when we have long term policies, policies which are worried and occupied with the climate change, they are also promoting a better practices or better practices in our farms. So it's a win-win situation, and we have several numbers to acknowledge and to show that. But 2030 is around the corner. It's just less than 8 years. It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And there, it's the challenges after that is completely different. Mm-hmm. Completely different to turn these figures into this deep dark green, sequestering so much. It's a huge challenge. And the thing is that we do not know how to do it. We don't know. we don't know how to sequester so much. Probably there are some systems that are sequestering so much carbon, but we do not know massively. I would say we have some data, scattered data, but we don't know those systems that we should promote. So we are really looking forward to work together with other organizations, other companies, to detect those systems which are, at least they have the promise to sequester carbon, because the next 5, 6, 7 years, we are going to be defining the 30s, 2030s, 2040s, if it's going to be feasible to sequester this carbon that afterwards we are going to get some money from that or not. We have to invest a lot on research in science. Agriculture, we have global views, but the solutions are local. So we need to research at local level. And this is what we do in Korea, what we do with APRESID as well. So to finish, to align what our beliefs, our diagnosis, the policies, and the allocation of resources is extremely important to have this climate smart as a to be part of the solution of the climate crisis. Thank you.
Thank you, Christian. Great presentation with a lot of great inputs on both, again, opportunities and challenges, and this time from perspective of a farmers association and how farmers play a role in this whole discussion. Now, last but not least, we have Mauricio Rodriguez. He's the head of the Latin American region for crop science. He is also a member of the division's executive leadership team. He has over 20 years of experience, especially in the ag business, risk management, and leadership of large groups in multiple regions. And he has global experience with international assignments, both in the US and Mexico. He has a degree in civil engineering and an MBA in finance from the International Business and Management Education Center. And then, many, many studies, a postgraduate degree in controllership, and also extensions at Wharton School and Washington University. So without further ado, you have the floor. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And well, first of all, thanks a lot for the invitation from ICA. It's a pleasure to be here in such a sophisticated panel. I hope that I can be up to the level of the panel. As you could hear, I'm a civil engineer, so I'll do my best here to represent it. But a civil engineer with more than 20 years working with agriculture. So it's really a pleasure to be here. And the idea, we just brought a few slides here just to share a little bit of our journey, what we have been doing in Bayer, and sharing a little bit of our perspective. It's great to hear some of the ideas, see some of the consistency, and especially to learn how we can better collaborate, how we can better learn, and the, let's say, the importance of the involvement of the private institutions collaborating with government and so on. So that's pretty much the journey that we'll be going through and what we would like to share here today. So if you could pass the first slide, that would be great. So first I would just start with our strategic foundation, just to share a little bit where we're going. So before we jump into that, I assume that most of you know, but we're formed by a company, Bayer, for 3 divisions. And we're pretty much talking here more focused on the crop science one, which is roughly half of the company, other than the pharmaceuticals and the consumer health also are part of the whole discussions, which leads to our main goal of the company, what we keep typically say, health for all and hunger for none. It's a combination of the pharma divisions and also the efforts that we're doing crop science more focused in agriculture. But from our purpose to the vision and the strategic goals are pretty much focused on pretty much 3 pillars. Anything that we focus on innovation needs to be combined with efforts in terms of sustainability, and of course, with our journey in terms of digital transformation. And why do I say that? We've been focusing a lot in our innovation historically. We're a company that globally, on a yearly basis, we invest more than 2 billion euro from an R&D perspective in crop science. And innovation is in the core of our business, but we don't think innovation without combining that to sustainability goals. And at the same time, how do we accelerate our digital transformation? Because we all believe that these three pillars need to go hand in hand. And if and of course, I heard all that you guys were talking, how do we focus on our growers and at the same time connect to our people? But creating this three pillar to try to connect with our growth-centered idea, which is at the end of the day, how do we incentivize, how do we help, and how do we help our farmers, both the big ones and the small ones that I'll mention in a second, to continue to develop themselves, okay? So if you could now shift to the second one. These are three very straightforward commitments that we have as a company for the next few years. And this is typically, we try to be very straightforward, 30, 30, 100. And the 30, 30, 100, we combine here with the United Nations priorities. But at the end of the day is how do we reduce by 30% our greenhouse emissions? How do we reduce the environmental impact of our crop protection products by 30% at the same time? And how do we empower more than 100 million smallholders around the world? So there's a ton of effort done in each one of these that will show a little bit what we're doing. I just wanted to emphasize a little bit. I had the opportunity to be in a panel a few months ago, and we explored so much about food security. And this one, I think at least we tend to, on a day-to-day, you're focusing a lot on your big growers, but we are clear for us that most of the food that is generated around the world is by more than 500 million smallholders around the world. We want to make sure that 20% of that, that we're empowering them and making sure that these guys can continue to develop. So there's a lot of effort this globally, not only, of course, in Latin America. There's a big effort in India. There's a big effort in Asia and Africa in general. But Latin America has this source of contribution to that. And it's pretty much linked to anything that we have, both in terms of education, products, partnerships, and there's a lot of collaboration involved into that. So if you could move to the next slide, please. So these are some of the levers that we believe that should help us to achieve our commitments. And pretty much comes through a number of topics. So starting with how to maximize the soil carbon pool through cover crops, but at the same time combining that to an extremely advanced breeding technology and additional crop protection products to continue to increase yields and produce more at the same amount of land. The same thing combining with a lot of irrigation systems. We focused a lot of our attention in terms of how do we continue to incentivize the digital farming, the precision farming. So there's a lot of investments, and I'll come back to that in a second. And at the same time, one thing that, of course, is extremely important, then there's a substantial already advancement in some of our countries in the Southern Hemisphere, which is the no-till farming and the crop rotation. So a lot of efforts on that in order to continue to focus on the three pillars. And we don't believe that one of these pillars should be in detriment of any of the others. So getting to yield increase, of course, is a big portion of our efforts, but that needs to be combined with the greenhouse gas emission reduction at the same time with the soil carbon sequestration. So that's pretty much the idea of using a lot of these levers, and we've been constantly focusing on that. How do we combine the new technologies that we're bringing to the field to new ways of producing on that, to measure these new ways of producing so that we can get to the results that we want here with these three pillars. And pretty much, and I think you touched on that, Martin, some of the challenges that we continue to focus. So we do have a significant carbon program in South America. Pretty much we launched that in Brazil and Argentina with roughly around 2,000 growers that we have included into that. And I would say that we've been learning a lot. So for us as a company, if I could say that, it is kind of interesting and different because historically you're talking about a company that is science focused, that we're used to focus on breeding, developing new products and so on. And partnership was inside, but in this environment, of course, collaboration, partnerships and learning with government officials, with a lot of different sectors in the market, it's even more important. The challenge that we're facing in this, and as I said, we're still in this journey and there's a lot to be done, but it's pretty much something that is already being said here. So how do you promote this low carbon agriculture and how can we continue to educate on that? How can you measure, monitor and create scalability for this? And some of our tools are what we're doing in order, especially to measure and monitor this so that it can be scalable in the future. We talked a little bit about this tropicalization because most of our protocols are done for the Northern Hemisphere. How do you tropicalize that, if I can use this neologism? And finally, of course, the lack of proper regulation. So I think we're giving our share of effort and I think we're advancing on that. But of course, we're still kind of, let's say, restricted. And at the same time, as many of you said, we understand the importance and the relevance of the agricultural market in these solutions. And we need to continue to partner so that each one of the players can help us to solve some of these challenges that we foresee in the near future. And part of the solutions that we've been using, part of the tools, and I would say I was in the company when we bought Climate, and it's interesting to see so many years later what we shoot at in the beginning and where we are. So we were pretty much in the beginning, Climate was not seen as an enabler for many of other things. And Climate nowadays is in the middle of everything that we're doing because it's pretty much a tool for us to capture more data and how can we leverage from this data. And we're not talking about something that is still as planned. So we're talking about more than 80 million hectares or 200 million subscribed acres already with the number one digital ag brand. Operating in more than 20 countries. We're extremely solid in both Brazil and Argentina with the largest database of grower and field trial seed performance. And we have a lot of partnerships in this platform. And why do you think this is important? Because at the end of the day, our goal is to even more to offer solutions for our customers and not only focusing on products. And we believe that Climate is certainly a very important and critical tool for us to offer even more these, let's say, tailor-made solutions and at the same time share even more data with our customers. So this is in the middle of the carbon project, is in the middle of some outcome-based solutions that we're offering to our customers. And this, for me, is going to be the bulk and the main instrument for us to continue to develop in terms of sustainability in all different fronts. So how can you measure, how can you detect that, and how can you offer more tailor-made products for our customers in general? And I didn't mention in the beginning, but one thing that is interesting for us being in Latin America, it is different from many other sectors. We are extremely important internally for the company. So we're the second biggest region, being second very close to the first one, which is North America, which is different from many other sectors. So the importance of Latin America is roughly a fourth of what we have globally for the company. And why do I say that? Not because of the revenue itself, but because of the importance that it represents, the amount of investments that we can bring to the region, the amount of attention that we can bring so that we can offer more tailor-made solutions. So that is extremely important. And within these countries, within this region, Brazil is the biggest country, but Argentina is the second one. The importance of the Cono Sur, or the southern corn, is extremely important for us. And we at the end of the day, try to leverage some of this importance within the company to bring more technology, to even bring some specific technologies for the region, and at the same time, get the same amount of resources as we offer in terms of revenue for the company. So I would say this is critical for us to move in our mission, because of course we can always raise the hand and say we need effort, we need help, we need resources, and we're typically in the, let's say, in one of the front seats for that. And just bringing that, because not necessarily that happens in all other sectors of different industries. And this is, I love this slide just because we brought this just to show sometimes people don't have a perspective of what happened in the last 80 years. And again, I was just asking the guys, I saw this the other day in the US in a meeting that we had with some investors. And for people that has no idea about what is the benefit of agriculture, because many times we're saying we're planting more in the same land. I think this shows pretty much what we're saying here. So this is what in 1940 we needed in terms of land to produce the same amount of production that we have in this type of land. So many times people don't understand why do we say the investments in increasing yield is so important. And this is trying to show it's not only about, oh, this is just technologies, it's just by technologies, new crop protection products, and so on. This is what it's bringing. So this was roughly, we made the calculation around 5 or 6 times less land than what we have there. And of course, this is completely connected with any sustainability goals, but we continue to develop ourselves. So not only in the main crops, but what can we do in all the different crops that we have around the globe. And at the end of the day, the continued effort in investment in innovation is what we believe that combined with many other efforts, especially in terms of digital transformation, will help us bring to a much more sustainable future. So I think this was my last slide. I just wanted to, this was a kind of a backup. Yeah. I think I shared it, but just would like to thank you again for the invitation. If there's any questions or anything, glad to hear it.
Thank you so much. This was also a great presentation, and particularly the last slide is very graphic in, you know, transmitting the message of how important technology and knowledge and investing in all these areas is to agriculture and to being part of the solution to climate change. So thank you. So now we have just a few minutes for some questions. If we have any from the audience, we have about 5 to 10 minutes to discuss. Tell you. Yeah.
Thank you for your presentations. I wanted to hear from each of you, what is the partnership or the partner that you think is missing to help you advance a little faster towards the goals that you all presented?
Well, that's a difficult question. And I'm first. I think from a very probably Argentine perspective is to see that government officials and government institutions kind of understand the type of challenge we're facing. And it's not only climate change for agriculture, but it also has to do with trade and trade multilateral organizations. And I think that the work of IECA this year is really relevant, because I think we need to support those that belong to the government today, professionals that are doing their careers in the public sector as public servants, but also those political appointed persons. So I think that's and that's why I think it's so relevant, that because that also this year is the first time that ICC has a pavilion, and that it's the first COP where you find the business hub. And I think that's extremely relevant to have these type of organizations and multilateral organizations like IECA getting together and saying, okay, how can we support that from that type of system? So I think.
Thanks.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, I have two questions. First, I agree completely with Martin.
Sometimes to get to these solutions is partnership, but sometimes it's not only the partnership, but the other actor made the framework, established the framework that we need. In this regard, I agree. And the other thing is, I believe in Argentina, we have to establish, we have a lot of things done together with another organizations like a Proceed, a Bayer, or something, some other institutions. I think we have to focus next projects to cope with climate change, because previously we have a lot of programs trying to resolve other issues, which are important, of course. But I believe that in the next time, the focus should be this climate change issues, or at least to filter all aspects, our projects, with which is the impact of on climate change. And of course, money. So the other partnership that we will need is to finance the how to cope with these challenges.
Good. And I feel like I have probably the same as you guys mentioned, but just offering a little bit of a different perspective. So as I mentioned in the presentation, I think we've been doing a lot of partnership and collaboration with some government institutions around Latin America in general. But there's always a lot of need, because technology in many cases advances pretty fast. The regulations don't come at the same speed. And that doesn't help to support some of the technologies. And we've seen and we've proved the value of these new technologies. So getting regulations in place that can support that around the region, it is kind of critical for us to help continue to expedite, because the level of investment that we have, it's already in place. It's just a matter of how can we collaborate to make sure that the regulations make sense. So that would be number one. And the second one, as you said, especially in terms of the smallholders, and we were just having a very interesting conversation before this panel here. Whenever we're talking about smallholders, which for me is the most interesting one, I was in the southern of Mexico this year, and it's amazing. So it is great to be with big customers, 30,000, 50,000 hectares customers, and see their improvements. We're a lot for that. But when you see somebody coming from 2 hectares to 20 hectares and you see the value of what you're really bringing, that for me is life-changing. And that for me is the most difficult one, because typically we're selling a piece of that. We need to have a lot of different people involved. How do you get funding for that? I think that is the most interesting one, because you need to have a lot of different partnerships. How do you connect that and how do you fund this? For me, is probably the second thing that it's not that it's missing, but we need to accelerate much more than what we have nowadays.
Thank you. So maybe we have 2 minutes if there's any other questions. Kelly has another question. Yes, of course.
I'll dominate since everybody's tired. I wanted to ask for you, you know, this is not a space that agriculture has traditionally participated in, the COP. And so what for you is the most positive outcome or objective that you find or are looking for from the participation of the agriculture sector here? And I had one more question.
You want me to start?
Yeah.
Okay. I think, and this is probably like way out, close to the moon or even way out there. It's to see that climate change experts, like IPCC, agriculture experts, trade experts, and now carbon markets, we all start to share the same language. And when one says long-term, it means the same for the other. When one says greenhouse gas emissions, it has the same meaning for the others. And when one says like a cow, it's not for us like evil or the enemy, right? So I think those, what I've seen during this last 15 years of climate change things is that unfortunately we haven't reached the moment where the language that we use between these four sectors, that's diplomacy, climate change, agriculture, and global markets, and now carbon markets, that all is consistent. We all speak Spanish, like, for example, in Argentina, in our case, right? But still, there are such huge differences between what's being discussed at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, agriculture, the environment, and we need all that to be more or less consistent, right?
We are going to be happy if we leave the COP27 with first with the knowledge, because you can hear, and it's not my first COP, but every time that you come, you are seeing a bit of the future, where the world is going in regards to climate change. And as I mentioned, it's such a big impact. So you see a bit of the future. But we are going to be happy if we have an agenda with potential partners on how to start to design the solutions of the future.
I like it, this last one. Well, I personally feel like this is a great opportunity for us to engage and learn. So first of all, I think we need to be humble enough to say we're all here learning together, and the different industries. And I feel like we need to change the narrative, because historically, I think the ag business has been seen only as part of the problem. But we're not being perceived as part of the solution, which clearly we are. And so I always feel like when it happens, it's not only because people are not willing to listen to that. We're probably not communicating good enough. So what I try to hear here, and today I walk it a lot here to listen and to see what people are doing in terms of communication. How can we help that? And not because communication is the only thing. You're going to engage much more, even the sector, the more that they are perceived as part of the solution, not only in terms of speaking, but in terms of real actions. And I'm extremely convinced about that. It's just a matter of how do we put that in action much more. So.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much for the questions, for the presentations. Thank you to all the speakers. We have to wrap it up. Unfortunately, we're at the end of the hour. Again, thank you to ICA for hosting us and having given the opportunity to have this event. And while we look forward to continuing this discussion, it was great to hear from all of you. Thank you. Thank you.
Excellent. Very well. I'm going to go to the next one.